Hi, I'm Mary McGorry, Assistant Dean for the Division of Business and Technology at Community College of Philadelphia. Today, Chef Maria Campbell from the Culinary Arts and Hospitality Management Program will be showing us different types of condiments and how to make them. You'll really enjoy watching this. If you need more information about the Culinary Arts and Hospitality Management Program, please contact us at the college.
Hi, my name is Maria Campbell. I'm a chef instructor here at the Community College of Philadelphia. Today I'm going to show you some fun things for summer. Condiments, things that don't even require any cooking, which I think is really important. You want to keep things refreshing, very simple. What I'm going to start off with is a recipe called a honeydew chutney. It doesn't even really require much knife work other than this fancy Cuisinart mixer that can just chop it all up for you. What I did first was that I peeled my honeydew melon. I have a special way of doing it, which requires putting your knife on an angle and following the contour of the actual melon, keeping it intact. When I try to break it down even further, it's very important that you're holding the knife very safely. I use a very small knife because my hands are small. I'm going to cut this in half, and as you can see, the seeds are inside. You want to take a spoon and try to scrape this portion out because I don't need it. So I'm going to scrape this out. Just in the inside, I can tell it's really, really ripe. I always find people are smelling melons in the grocery store to see if it's ripe, but that's not really the appropriate way. You can actually touch the bottoms of the actual honeydew melon and just press on the ends and see if it has any give. If it's soft and it presses in and yields to your thumb, it actually means that it's ripe. So, from here, I can actually start cutting some small slices from inside. I'm going to start cutting some large chunks by first making slices. Take some of these together. You want to make sure you're very careful with your hands. And it doesn't matter what size they are because we're just going to put it into our little Cuisinart. This is fast, easy, simple. It doesn't require much knife skill. Since I already have this together, I'm going to take my pieces, put it inside, pick them up. They're slippery. Honeydew is very sweet in a subtle way. That's why I like to use this as a base. I'm actually going to take some cucumber. All of these ingredients are very refreshing. And it doesn't really matter how big or small the pieces are, because I'm just going to put it in the Robocoup, which is a short term here. Okay. All I need to do is kind of pulse this a little bit. So I'm going to hit the button. Grind it up a little. Until it becomes smooth. It's really fast. Okay, that part is done. Then what I'm going to do is I want some herbs, something refreshing. I mean, we already have some really nice ingredients, the honeydew, the cucumber, all naturally water-filled. All right, so what I'm going to do very carefully is I'm going to pinch up my fingers while I'm running my knife across to actually chop this portion. People feel that touching the knife is actually very dangerous, but it actually makes it very safe. You know where your fingers are all the time. So I'm going to run through just very roughly because I'm going to add it into our food processor again. I love the smell. It's very good. Add it into the top. I want to keep it kind of coarse. I don't want it to be too fine because otherwise the flavor can be a little too powerful. Cilantro is very strong. Don't need much. I actually grow this at home too. Okay, so I'm going to pulse it again. You can see the nice intermix of color, the dark green, light green. Okay. Normally I would use a microplane to kind of zest this off, but there is another way to actually create zest. Again, following the contour of the actual lime itself, you can actually very small scrape without taking the white portion, take off the zest. If you're afraid of using a larger knife, you can use something small and cut little strips. The knife should be very sharp in order to do this. All right. This does require some knife skill, but a microplane would do just fine. Now, I'm going to cut some very, very thin strips into this. Very, very thin, very quickly, leaving it kind of rough. Because again, I'm just going to put it into here. Again, brightening. You have to balance when you're trying to make something very simple. Don't need a lot of ingredients to make something taste good. The honeydew is sweet. Cucumber is fresh. I'm going to add some citrus to brighten it up. Cilantro just accents that. Once we put this together, I actually take my limes, my lemons, and I roll them. This actually releases the juice into the inside so I can squeeze it and it comes out. Just for a little bit till it becomes soft and mushy. I can actually take my hand to it. All right, I'm actually massaging this lime here. All right, once I cut it in half, the juice wants to come out. Much easier than just letting it alone. And I just want to squeeze it and get all of that juice out. Again, it's the balance of it. I don't need to add much juice because there's lots of water content inside the actual cucumber and the honeydew melon itself. So I don't need to do much by adding liquid. Squeeze one more just for a little more brightening here. And you always have to taste everything you make. That's the fun part. My favorite. Mix it up. Okay, let me just taste just to make sure. Good, needs a little salt. Doesn't need too much. I always use kosher. It's easier to tell how much you're adding to it, and it has good flavor. Okay, and there we have our salsa. Very simply done, just mixed. It's really rough, that's why I still call it a chutney. Chutney is very rough chopped, or it could be a salsa. This goes great with steak, shrimp, chicken. I actually just served it for the summer. It's so refreshing, really, really bright. And it's one of my favorite recipes in the summertime. Doesn't need much, but it still tastes good. Okay, now I'm going to make a very simple, another very refreshing condiment, which is called a cucumber relish. I like to do it myself rather than buy, you know, pickles in the store. They're very briny, they're very salty, and you can't really control the flavor too much. It is what it is when you buy it. But if you actually make it, you can control the actual content and flavor profiles that you include. This is a seedless cucumber that I've already peeled. I take the outer edge off, and some people tell me that, well, the inside seeds make you burp. So I remove them. I'm going to cut into it and channel out using a V-shaped pattern with the knife to remove the seeds, even though it is a seedless cucumber. Channel again, just making a V to remove this section. Okay? Then I'm going to cut some batons, which is just a wide strip. This does require some knife skill, and I'm just dragging the knife through. It's easier to cut this many at a time. And try to cut a nice little medium dice. I love doing this stuff for parties. And again, cucumbers. People think cucumbers and they think refreshing. And that's what summer is about, cooling down when it's hot. So I take these, I enter it into a little dish here. And I make what's called a brine solution. To make a brine solution, this is actually what it makes this a quick pickle. It's very fast and it's very simple. Water, cold. Okay. Then I use a white vinegar. I like to flavor it using like white wine vinegar, rice vinegar, anything that has flavor more than distilled. Pour a portion of that in. Mix it up. And then I add 50-50 parts, or actually equal parts, I should say, of salt and sugar. No matter how much salt I add into here, I have to make sure I add equal parts sugar. So I've done 2 pinches so far, so I'm going to do 2 pinches of sugar and mix that together. I always taste the liquid itself. It should taste a little vinegary, a little sweet, a little salty, however you prefer. And it does. All this needs to do is sit for 30 seconds minimum, and probably about, it'll last up to 3 days if you wanted to keep it, and it will discolor each day because it is pickling. It's refresh, tasty. I would drain it and then serve it with either maybe some flatbread pitas or maybe something else that's heavier like lamb meatballs during the summertime, or kebabs as a side. And there you have it, quick pickled cucumbers. The next is a pineapple salsa. I find this pineapple is a real treat to have. If anybody has it at a party, I get really excited about it. It's a very versatile product. As long as it is sweet, which most of the times it is, it's also very acidic. So you have to be careful with what you pair it with, because you don't want to add a lot of acid to this, because it can actually burn your mouth if you eat it in large quantity. But everybody loves pineapple. It's a real treat. There's a couple ways of actually peeling and coring a pineapple. You want to actually cut the top off. And again, this is something else that I test the bottoms, and I always see people sniffing them, and I don't know what they're actually doing when they're doing that. But you should see some yellowish content, and the softer it is on the bottom, the better that it actually is. Sometimes you can save these too to make something look really nice. I'm going to cut the bottom off using my knife. And I'm going to take off all of this section, again, following the contour shape, which is very similar to what I did with the honeydew melon. Cut this down. There's lots of eyes that are around the outside of this. Now, there is a fancy way to actually save this portion and not actually cut off what we call the meat of the actual product. Even though it's not meat, you don't want to take off a lot of the yellow portion of it. Because although pineapple is good, it is expensive. So I shave off all of these portions, trying to cut the contour. I leave the eyes alone so that I don't trim off too much, because you can always take off more. Okay? Don't need this anymore. Very important that you keep your board clean so you don't slip or resist, because a knife is very dangerous. See how I have all the eyes that are here on the outside? What I could do is actually, you can actually make a spiraling effect by channeling this out, which I have seen some very talented people do with a knife. It is difficult, but it is possible to actually go down and actually trim out each of these portions, which makes a really nice buffet item, to actually cut this out. And that way I'm only concentrating on the areas that have the eyes on them. I could continue to do this, but I'll show you how to take off these eyes. It's easier just to make this little scraping without taking off a lot of meat. I'm only concentrating on the areas that have darkened spots, taking them off. All right. The seeds are in those areas. It's actually how it tries to reproduce itself. And you can see little seed portions in here behind the eyes. They're very protected. Oh, I can smell it already. It's very slippery. You have to be really careful because there's a lot of sugar content that's in the pineapple. You want to remove them all. Taking off all the eyes, because they're not really that edible, although we can eat seeds. We always go for the care for the customer is always my motto. Not about me, it's about them. Okay. Well, there's a large core that actually sits in the center here. And what I like to do is I want to utilize everything that I can off of this pineapple itself without wasting anything. So I like to cut this into four sections. Trying to go along where the lighter area is, where I can see in here, try to cut as much meat as I can. So I cut down. It's more fibrous in this area. The more of these that you cut, the easier it is for you to tell. But you can actually feel how grainy it may be in those areas. That's how I can tell that I have a portion of the core. You want the flesh to still be soft. And this is what you should have left over. I can still juice this. I can still use it for different preparations. But for now, I don't need it. You can do any extra trimming that you may have missed that you didn't see in the first round. And here's where some of the knife skill comes into play. This I'm not going to put in a food processor, but I'm going to cut it really nice with my knife. I'm going to cut long strips, pretty narrow, because I want to make a nice dice. You could put this in the food processor if you wanted to make this process really fast. But I just love the way a dice looks. And it is a skill. Especially for students that are trying to learn how to do this. It is a standard that's in the industry to be able to do knife cuts. This is a nice small dice, a Brunoise cut. The more uniform it looks, the better it's going to look when it's finished. You can double stack in order to cut. I'm always touching the knife because I want to be safe and know where it is. It took a lot of practice to get there, and it feels uncomfortable when you're learning how to do it. And the students always say, wow, I can't believe you're actually touching the knife, but it is safe. I'm going to finish cutting these last two portions. I always line them up together so I can get nice straight lines. I'm also making a grid in a sense. Cutting lines and then cutting across. So you should have a nice dice that's left over here. Grab this. I'm going to put this nice dice in here just to clear some space. Being very careful to pick this up. Okay. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a little bit of jalapeno to add some heat to it. Something that's very sweet is balanced so easily with something that's hot. I really find that you have to find the contrast. With everything that I've made, you try to find the balance, which is so important, and why it makes it refreshing in the first place. So what I'm going to do is, people think jalapenos, they're so hot, but I'm actually going to remove the seeds. That's the hot portion, which is right in here. If you remove this or roast, you can actually roast a jalapeno. It's really not that spicy because the heat is not in the flesh, but in the seeds. So I'm going to remove that portion. Because I don't want the heat. I just want a subtlety to actually intertwine with the actual pineapple. I'll rinse it off. I'm going to make a nice little dice again. Let's remove this little channel here. Like I said, no seeds. If I want to remove them, take them off the board. All right, I'm going to make nice little julienne strips. Okay, and make a nice little dice. Very, very, very small. This will add a nice contrast of different sizes, different colors. It'll brighten it up. Like I said, I could add a roasted pepper to this. There's plenty of products out there if you don't want to cut it yourself. So, I'm going to take a small portion compared to what I did here. Okay. Remove this. And again, love cilantro in the summer. So I'm just going to cut up a little portion like this and do a chopping motion, putting my hand on the edge of the knife here using the palm of my hand here. I'm actually going to do a rocking pivot. I never move this hand. I'm always moving my other hand, and I am right-handed. You would do this left-handed as well. But you don't want to slide down because that's very dangerous. So I'm going to rock back and forth. I'm not moving my left hand, just to kind of rough this up a little bit. Scraping the board to pick up the pieces so that I can keep chopping as I'm moving along. Scraping off the knife very carefully, just so that I can get it so it's not a recognizable leaf. Then I'll scrape it up, add it into my portion here. Okay. To add some different texture and juice, I'm actually going to take the other portion of this pineapple, throw it into the food processor, and mix it up. This is how you get a different texture. I want it to become like puree, which it is. Once I have this, I can then add it into my other mixture here. And then I have two different kinds of texture. I made a mess there. I have the actual dice that I cut up. And then I also have this nice puree, which acts as a moisture content in here to kind of make it more like a salsa, which is what I'm trying to go for. Some people just cut stuff and then they don't have any moisture, and I love it. I would take this, I would serve it with some shrimp, which is very beautiful. Chicken, coconut. Really goes with a lot of flavors using tropical varieties. And you can do this with any fruit. If you love mangoes, use mangoes. Whatever your favorite is, you can use it. I've even seen people make strawberry salsa. And it just looks really, really beautiful as well as tastes delicious. I'm going to be making a marinade, which is called actually a green marinade. I've been experimenting a lot with these kind of products to add more flavor to your meats and proteins before you put them on the grill. I don't cook anything on the grill unless I marinate it for a minimum of 30 minutes. I love to set things overnight. That way it really has a chance to impart its flavor before you put it on there. Once you put something on a grill, it actually takes a lot of the moisture away from it. So you want to re-add that by tenderizing the product, retaining moisture. And that can be done with marinades or brines. So what I'm going to do is you can see all of my green fresh herbs here that I'm going to impart on a chicken breast that they actually call them split at the store that actually has the bone underneath of it. I love to impart the bone as much as possible because it adds more flavor and again retains moisture. So it's very important that we try to think of all the levels. How can I add more flavor? What can I do? And always understanding the natural product itself can really help aid that process. So I have a bunch of different herbs here, and you can use whatever you like. I have chives, I have some rosemary, I have some tarragon, and some scallions as my onion flavor. Tarragon is very, very bright, goes well with seafood and chicken, but it's very light and mellow. Rosemary, very strong. And this actually has a very light kind of onion flavor in comparison to the scallion, which is very, very pungent. Having a balance again with these flavors can really, really add flavor without becoming too strong. This isn't something you just want to dump everything in, but it makes it very easy to put it in our food processor. So I'm just going to cut it up a little bit because herbs don't really have a good chance of combining in your food processor without a little bit of liquid. And the liquid I'm going to use is a little bit of extra virgin olive oil to help it combine like a pesto. So I'm going to put this in. I'm actually going to break this up a little bit, pulling it off of the stem to actually release some of that flavor. The stalk is not very good. It's actually fibrous in flavor. So I'm going to peel this down and remove this. Add this in here, do a little sprinkle. It doesn't really matter what you're trying to add as long as you add what you like, is what I say. I peel this down, to actually pick off the leaves, because again, you don't really want the stem, even though it is a marinade. Someone could get a piece by the time they're ready to eat it, and you don't want that. So I pick all this off. I love tarragon. I really want this to show through. And you need more tarragon because it's not as strong as the rest. When it's competing against strong flavors, you have to add twice as much to overcome. Otherwise, it won't be visible in the notes of flavor. I'm going to chop this up just a little bit. Like I said, it has a hard time trying to combine itself. And add that in too. Everything green. That's why I call it a green marinade. Okay. I'm going to add a little bit of this oil inside here. Makes it real easy. I've probably added about half a cup. Discard these. And what I'd like to do is actually, again, add a little more of the actual lemon into the product here because I want to make it bright. I have lots of things in there that are flat in flavor. As a chef, it's really important to balance. So with here, understanding that herbs have this tone on your tongue that dissipate very quickly, I'm going to add an acid. Because I don't want to cure the actual meat product, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the oil, which is actually inside the outside of this lemon, rather than adding the juice. I'm just going to chop this up. I'm going to use my other knife really quickly. Because it doesn't matter how I really cut it, because I'm going to put it in here just to brighten it. Now, lemon and salt have a way of bringing out flavor and making it taste stronger. It's not so that it tastes salty, it's so that it tastes stronger. I'm going to take a little bit more of this because I want it to be really refreshing. Cut some more up, just dice it up a little bit. And add this last portion into my sauce here, marinade. And I just want to combine it till it becomes smooth like pesto. It can be as rough or smooth as you like. I like it a little coarse. Okay. Then I'm actually going to take the chicken itself and just rub this all over the outside of the chicken. It kind of looks really sloppy, but I'll tell you, I've had so many compliments since I make this all the time because there's more flavor than just taking a plain chicken and putting it onto the grill. You want to rub it into the actual chicken. Yeah, you want to get a little fresh. All right. Rub it in all the crevices. All right. So that it's completely coated. Now, I don't want to add the actual lemon juice to it at this point because I don't want it to cure. The meat becomes tough. It becomes very difficult to actually cook it. You want to make sure that this flavor sits on there for a while to actually impart. The oil has flavor. You can add garlic to this if you like. Depends on what you like. But what you'd like to do when you actually marinate something is you should take plastic and actually sit it on top of it, almost like a vacuum seal. This will actually help keep the marinade intact and actually coat the product as it sits. I always do this to everything I marinate. I try to keep the air minimal and the marinade a lot. Once I would do this, I would leave this for about 30 minutes, like I said, minimum. I always leave this usually overnight when I do this because the bone, it takes a little while for it to actually impart through. But I'll tell you, you taste this all the way through once you put it on the grill. And there we have a green marinade that I can either grill this or I can actually roast it. I'm going to show you now that I've made all of these salsas how to make something that matches and pairs with it. You think summer? You definitely have to think coconut, tropical. All of these flavors really come through in the summertime because we can't really get them in the winter. So what I'm going to actually show you is I have some deveined peeled shrimp that were actually already done for me, which I like to do. I like to keep it simple in the summer, especially if I'm at home. The students here have to learn how to devein and actually peel the shrimp. But it does make it easier when you're trying to do it. So what I'm actually going to start off with first is I'm going to make what I did earlier, actually, was an egg mixture and set up a breading station. I actually have panko breadcrumbs. Usually I like to do this because it adds more of a texture. You can use cornmeal, you can use whatever it is that you prefer as a texture to start as your breading. I think this actually retains a lot more crunch. It really doesn't mush up when you try to fry it. It's a personal preference of mine. But where people forget to add flavor is actually in the crumb itself. This is some shredded coconut that I've actually purchased. You can actually toast it, it's untoasted. And I like to add this for more texture, leaving it kind of rough. And if they fall off, it's okay. They're still going to impart their flavor. So I mix this into the breading portion itself. Whatever I put in here will be actually coated to the back of the actual shrimp. What I also have is a little bit of coconut milk. I can actually add this to the actual egg mixture to impart more flavor again. The egg acts as a binder to actually hold the actual coating to it so that it doesn't fall off. Again, I'm adding more flavor. Rather than just doing a simple breading where I just do egg, salt, pepper, and flour, and maybe just some pre-made breadcrumbs. On the back here, what I have is an actual kind of made-up fryer. You have to get a little creative sometimes in the kitchen when you don't have equipment that you actually need. I haven't actually monitored by using this temperature control that has a cord, and it actually has a gauge in the inside to let me know when it reaches a certain temp. I'm looking for 350 degrees, so I set it for 350 degrees. Right now it's at about 210. The only problem with using these ones on the stove is that I have to constantly turn it up and down to regulate the temperature. It doesn't have a regulator. If you buy one at the store, it would be much easier, and I highly recommend them because they're very inexpensive. How I'm going to start this off is you want to have a wet hand and a dry hand. It doesn't really matter which one you choose. Left-handed, right-handed, doesn't matter as long as one is wet and one is dry. So how I'm going to begin is, I need actually a plate. Hold on one second. How I'm going to begin is I'm actually going to take the actual shrimp, dip it into the egg mixture with my wet hand, let it drip a little. Let me check my temperature. We're getting there. And then I'm going to dip it into here using my dry hand to actually coat the outside of the shrimp. Using my dry hand to pick it up and place it here. And then I'm just gonna start the process all over again. As long as I'm using a wet hand, using the actual tail of the shrimp to hold this, dipping it into my breading. Making sure it's fully coated. Again, you gotta be a little ambidextrous to do this. And if you want a little more breading, you can always just smush some more on there. I'm gonna do it again. Very simple. And again, add any flavors that you like. You can add herbs in this process, but you have to be careful that when you add herbs to the actual breading portion of it, they should be dry because they can burn very easily. Once it's coated here, I can actually pick them up. Washing hands is important. What I would do with this part is I would actually be ready to actually dip this into the actual fryer oil. Right next to me, I have an actual tray that has a rack on it with a little bit of paper towels. I do this to actually leave a place for it to drip, and also I want to make sure this stays crispy. When you fry something, you don't want it to be greasy. The reason it becomes greasy is because your oil is usually not hot enough, or you leave it in too long to become dark. You have to be careful because sometimes when your oil is really clean, it's not going to impart a very dark color because your oil is clean. So everyone always says it's not changing color. You still have to cook it as long as you think it takes. Shrimp in a fryer will probably take about anywhere between 5 and 7 minutes. If it's much longer than that, it's probably done. I'm gonna let them drop in. See, nice little bubbles, so that's good. And what I'm going to use is what's called a spider. We call this a spider. We actually use this to fish this out. It has holes and perforated holes so that you can actually drip out the actual oil, because again, I don't want it to actually stick to the product. I give it a stir. I'm going to let that cook for a little while. Shrimp does not take very long, and in this case, since I have it nice and hot, it's going to cook really quickly. I kind of stir it around a little bit and pull it up just so that I can see and make sure that it's cooked all the way through. Because when shrimp is usually done, it'll turn all pink in color. And it won't have any gray. I can see that there's a little bit of gray on this beginning portion, so I want to leave it in a little longer. The only color I'm looking for is the red and opaque solid structure of the shrimp itself. This goes really well with our pineapple salsa. Could also really go well with our honeydew chutney that we've made earlier as well. Anything refreshing. I love to make dipping sauces for our items, because it also gives you another chance to add more flavor. Almost. It's only been a couple minutes. Looking for the bubbles, trying to be very careful, looking for this opaque color, which I'm really starting to see. Oh, that looks great. I'm going to actually drip that out over the actual oil itself, turning down my heat a little bit for safety, and I let it drip over the edge here. It's always important to salt your products as soon as it comes out of the fryer, so that way the oil itself will actually help the salt stick to the product. If it's actually dry, it's been sitting out for a little while, you'll just see the salt fall right off of the product and it won't stay on. I love to serve this with any kind of salsa. It's really great to have as a great appetizer for items you're making, and guests really love it. So I'm going to take this. And there we have some coconut fried shrimp with our honeydew salsa that we made earlier. The next thing I'm going to be making is actually a skewered chicken tender. I love to use the actual inside underneath the breast portion of the chicken. Although its name is chicken tender, it is very tender in texture. And plus, you don't need to do any cutting. The size is perfect for it to be actually skewered, which I'm going to show you how to do to put it on a grill. The first thing I like to do is I always want to coat and add flavor. And the best way to do that is by adding different spices. I like to use things in the whole form first before I start using things that are in a powdered form. But when they're in the whole form, meaning like a seed, or this is a cardamom pod, or seed, excuse me, that I like to toast them first. The oils are trapped inside. They have a little bit of a smell, but to actually make them come out, I add heat. So I put them into an actual dry sauté pan, which just means I've added no cooking medium whatsoever. I put this, and I like to do a constant motion so it doesn't burn. I only want to toast until I can smell it. Once I can get the smell, I can add the one that's a little bit smaller. This is a celery seed. I add the second layer. Since I know the cardamom seeds take a little longer to cook, the celery seeds are so small they don't take as long in length. And I can smell it. I'm going to add it into my mortar and pestle. I love this tool. Oh, it smells good. So add it in. I'm going to actually use this, which it took me a really long time to actually find this. I've been on the hunt for years to try to find one this large. But it actually is a stone that you use another stone to actually grind up the actual seeds that are inside. So I'm going to take this. It makes it very easy because this is very heavy to actually just pound them a little bit. Do this circular motion to grind up the seeds. I always feel like cardamom smells like lime. Has this kind of almost, which will sound funny, maybe like Fruit Loops, but it really has this sweet smell to it that you can't really get from just using a powder, like a ground form. So I want to make sure that I don't want anybody to choke, so I want to make sure I pound this up very, very small to make it edible. And let the stone do the work. That's what it's for. Okay, so I got that ground up pretty well. I'm going to add a little bit of other flavors here. I have a little bit of, forgot what I put in. Coriander. That's what I put in here. Sometimes I even forget. Mix that together just till it smells good. Really, rubs can be made just until they have a really nice aroma. I'm going to put this into the bottom here. So you can see that. All right, should be light and airy, and it really has a lot of impact. I'm then going to add a little bit of sesame seeds, and I'm going to do the similar action here. And the reason why I separate these is because sesame seeds have a lot of oil in them. And I don't want to do it in any, like I said before, I want it to be a dry pan. So because they have this natural oil content, they have to be done alone. With this nice swirling motion. They should color a little bit and again have a really nice nutty aroma. Making almost a fusion with flavors because the flavors I have in that pan are very Latin in flavor, whereas this has a lot of influence from Asian cultures. You can't make fusion unless you understand about those cultures first, I always say. Knowing its roots is very important. Eventually, this will start to turn a very, very light tan color, and it happens very quickly and suddenly. And because of their natural oil content, I'm holding this very high above the flame so it doesn't burn, as they are very delicate, they almost pop like popcorn. I'm waiting for their oils to release. It takes a little time. Listening to your food is something that takes a lot of practice and being able to understand it. And yeah, you have to burn it a few times in order to know. The constant motion helps stop it from burning. If I let it sit still, it'll start to get dark spots on the bottom. I'm distributing the heat because I understand what the pan can do. Stainless steel is not a very good conductor of heat. So by moving it and being the manipulator of it, I have control of what the product is doing. Starting to turn a little more tan in color. I'd rather go slow and not burn it. Otherwise, I gotta start over. It has a really, really nice color. I am going to be cooking it a second time, so I don't want it to become too dark. And then I'll add it to my other mixture. It almost starts to look like it's wet once I cook it a little further. Mix all of these together. All right, and then I have a nice dry coating, like a nice rub that I can actually impart. Now what I have done, and people tend to forget, if you're gonna throw this on a grill, you can skewer chicken, you can skewer shrimp, you can skewer any meat, but you really should soak the skewer in water for at least a minimum of 30 minutes. It's wood. If it gets hot, it's gonna burn. So you have to be very careful. They come in all different sizes. I've actually manipulated this by just trimming off the top. You can use scissors, you can cut them to any size, 14 inches, whatever you're looking for. This is a nice size for like a little appetizer. And since the chicken is already the perfect size that I'm looking for here, What I'm going to do is I'm going to stick it into the inside of this, right into the center, like so. Trying to pick nice sizes here so that they're pretty uniform. There is a little tendon that runs through the middle of it, but it is edible, unlike other products where you have to remove them. Okay, set that there. And we'll do one more. Trying to find the center where I'm not poking through. I do it right down the middle to the end. You don't want to get through the other side either, because you don't want the customer, which to me, I always say customers being a chef, I am always serving it to people, which are the most important person, that you don't want it to get too close to the end too, because when you bite into it, it can really poke you in the roof of your mouth. So you don't want to leave a surprise for them. Once I've done this, I will take this portion and I'll do what I can do with my dry hand. Just taking a little bit of it, rubbing it onto the outside. Not adding salt at this time until I start cooking it in my pan. Give me a nice little coating to add a little more flavor. I'm all about flavor. You gotta add it in every layer that you can. Think about where I can do it. All right. Soaking the skewer is going to really, really help with this process. I've even seen sugar cane skewers that they've filled up or marinate. You can actually marinate the actual skewers themselves if you wanted to add flavor into the inside. Okay, so I've got that nice and coated with my own made seasoning, which I like to do. Sorry. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these actual tenders and I'm going to put them in my grill pan. You can just throw this on the grill, but this works just as fine, especially for small portions. What I'm going to do is you want this to get nice and smoky. You want it to get nice and hot before you actually try to cook something. So when I take it into the pan, you should hear that sizzle. We want to hear that. If I don't hear that, my pan's not hot enough. And I let it sit there. The more you keep agitating it, the more you keep moving it, the less color it's going to get. So I always try to encourage students and people that I encourage to cook to leave it alone sometimes. It may be better. You can always do the check. Lift it up. The great thing about cooking these as well is, especially if I'm doing this in a pan, if I'm worried about it not really cooking enough and getting the grill marks I want, I can finish them in the oven. And finishing them means I just get the color I want with cooking and grilling, and then I put it in the oven to finish cooking it the rest of the way through. Trying to get that really nice color. And again, the more I fuss with it, the less it's going to get. This can go with any condiment. I really love to pair something that has like a lime flavor with something that has like a pineapple essence. It really contrasts sweet, spicy with something that has a lot of depth with lime and kind of like a nut flavor. And the best way I feel to learn how to flavor is just to play around. I always tell people to research cultures, because I feel anything that's native to your region and area, they already know what flavors go together because it grows there naturally. And here, understanding that, then I can play on that and understand how to do more. And for me as a chef, I really enjoy doing that, trying to find ways to add freshness, trying to find ways to keep things light. As a woman, it's important to me, but I feel that if I don't make it that way and sell it in that way, people will want something that's refreshing because it's hot and you want to cool down. So I'm getting a nice color on there. My pan. This is going to take a while. Flip them. We got some nice color on there, and we want to really, really try to get it all the way through. Again, I don't have to finish cooking it on here. I could finish cooking it, you know, in the oven. If I had a grill, I can finish it, obviously, right on top of the grill, retaining moisture and keeping it really fresh. You can season at any time. As long as you don't overcook it, you can retain the moisture that's in it. I'm using a dry heat cooking technique, which as it's cooking is evaporating moisture. You can see steam coming off it. It's not just the pan, but the actual juices that are inside the meat are evaporating. So to retain that moisture, you can add it by accompanying it with a salsa, accompanying it with a condiment. But once you overcook it, it's really hard to try to match that up. So you want to be able to touch the meat if it has a lot of resistance to it. Right now it's very flimsy because it needs to be cooked longer. But when you're trying to test when it's done, this takes lots of practice. I find that cooking chicken tenders are probably the most simple of the preparations because they're nice and thin and it doesn't really take much to try to see if they're finished. Move them on the sides. What's really important is keeping the tops as nice as possible. I always try to focus on one side. It's always your show side that you show up. So that way, if I wanted to maneuver the bottom, I can move it as many times as I want without worrying about the way that it looks on the top and also finishing the cooking process the way it should be done. What I'm going to do is I'm going to add a pan over the top of this to kind of hold in the steam while making sort of like a little hot box so that it'll actually steam the rest of the way through. This is a very common cooking technique, especially on the line if you work at a restaurant. Everyone wants their order at a certain time, and how do they get it finished? There's a lot of little tricks in order to get that done so that you're not waiting for your food. Almost. I think that this skewers would go really well with the pineapple salsa. Nice. I'm looking for that resistance for me to be able to press onto it, and it's kind of like the way you look at a cake. If you press a cake and you want to know if it's done, it'll spring back on you and it'll actually remove your imprint from it. You do a similar testing on the actual flesh of the meat. And when you're doing that, you want it to spring back to you, but you don't want to feel it being very soft into the inside. These actually are done. Put them on the plate. The skewer leaves it very easy for them to pick it up and eat it. Okay, this looks beautiful. And I like to add the juice factor. I'm trying to keep it really, really refreshing and show that those two go with each other. Okay, then you can match this up with any other salsa. If you wanted to use the honeydew, you could, or we could use these fresh pickles. It's really up to you and how you want to actually pair it. But either way, you can have fun using all of these ingredients while cooling down in the summer by keeping it fresh and keeping it simple. Thank you for joining me today. I'm an instructor here at the Community College of Philadelphia, and if you'd like to check more about our culinary arts program, please check out the website at ccp.edu.